Episode number 3. Let's do it. Welcome to Footnotes, a behind-the-scenes look at what we value and why it matters here at Foothill Church in Glendora, California. My name is Stephen Koppenrath. I'm one of the pastors on staff, and I am your host. Hello, friends. Thanks for joining us. We would so appreciate you sharing this new podcast with other folks who may benefit from conversations like these. Just as a reminder, you can find us on foothill.church/footnotes, on Spotify, and on Apple Podcasts, where you can rate us 5 stars and leave a review if you feel so inclined. That'd be awesome. Today is all about community, which is obviously super important to all of us individually, but especially to the local church. One of the reasons why the last 5 months or so has been such a challenge is the distance between us and the people that we love. On this episode, we welcome Katie Dobransky, our groups minister here at Foothill Church. Katie wears lots of hats. She's a mom to Lily, Nathan, and Selah, right?
Yep, just those three. That's correct.
Yep. She's married to Steve Dobransky, who oversees our counseling and care ministry, and she's in seminary on top of all that as well. So you're kind of a busy person.
I call it fun.
Yeah, it is fun.
Yeah.
I remember a few months back, I was kind of peer pressuring you into starting a garden on top of all that.
Yes.
So that's too much. So don't do that.
Note for the audio, I've resisted.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's good. We are just getting ready to gear up for another season of growth groups here at Foothill Church. So tell us, Katie, let's say someone is maybe brand new to church, maybe brand new to groups in general. What exactly are growth groups?
Yeah, that's a good question, because we sometimes talk about growth groups like they're the most regular thing in the world to do. And I realize that they're not regular for everybody.
Right.
So
yeah.
For us here at Foothill Church, growth groups are groups of around 10 adults that meet together weekly, usually in somebody's home. And they discuss maybe the sermon, what was talked about, maybe a Bible passage for the upcoming sermon. I like to think of it as maybe if at church is where you learn about the Bible and you're taught, within groups is where we kind of learn to live that out. And we care for one another, and we find community there.
Yeah, cool. So groups has been a big part of our DNA as a church for years. I remember early on, 2007, 2008, We resourced around worship and kids and youth. But one of the first kind of things we got off the ground from the start was a small group ministry, growth group ministry. And this is a unique time, obviously. What's kind of different in this season coming up that is unique to, you know, this time that we're in compared to other seasons?
Yeah, well, I mean, most noticeably, we've been apart. So yeah. We are finding ourselves having to learn how to come back together in person in a safe way. And how do we, if we said community was so important before this pandemic hit, and we, you know, we talk a lot about it at Foothill Church and that it's important that you're in community, in this gospel-centered community. Well, within a pandemic, you can make an argument that it's even more important, yeah, or at least still holds the same value.
For sure.
And
yeah.
So I think we find ourselves in this spot of we have to learn how to do community in a time where not everyone's comfortable getting together in person, or not everyone's comfortable wearing masks while they're together in person, mm, or there's kids to think about. And so, yeah, we're doing our best with growth groups as we prepare for the fall season to consider all those things and to make adjustments. And so this year will look different for groups because we groups will be able to meet in person, but we'll, for now at least, all be meeting outside, whether that's in a park, in somebody's backyard. I'm kind of excited to see for the thought of our growth groups at Foothill Church meeting, you know, at a local park, like in Figbiter, and
sure,
discussing scripture and what they're learning and how that's applying to their life and really being out in the community. So that's exciting to me. That's something that will be different. And then we also have some groups that will choose to stay online because of just having that available for people who are not yet able or ready to meet in person. And so that's the biggest change, is just how we actually meet and connect with each other will need to still continue to look a little different.
Yeah. Yeah. So just getting really specific, like out of our groups, what percentage are kind of meeting maybe at someone's house, outside, in person versus Zoom this season?
Yeah, I would say actually a large percentage of our groups will be trying to meet in person outside.
Oh, yeah.
So maybe even about 85%. Cool. That's a weird number, but close enough. Mm-hmm. And then there will be a few groups that are choosing to stay online. Some that are open and then some that have members that are all returning, but they, because they know their members, they know that like, hey, they're, we can't meet in person yet. Yeah. A good note, I think you guys will be talking about classes maybe even next week, but all of our classes will be online. So that's mm-hmm. a spot for people who are not yet ready to try and meet in person to still find some community there too.
Yeah. 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 That outward facing aspect of groups this time around is actually really exciting because mm-hmm. Just last week we were talking with Whitney and Brian about the scavenger hunt and just even just the idea of Foothill Church people just kind of running around Glendora and, you know, in a hopefully winsome and helpful way, people seeing our church just out and about. And
yep.
So whether groups, you know, are meeting on Zoom, which some will do that, or if they're going to be in the backyard or at a park, just another opportunity to kind of just be seen in the community as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, we see really clearly in scripture that one of our biggest witnesses to the world will be how we treat each other and mm-hmm. how we care for each other. Mm-hmm. You know, Jesus tells his disciples, like, the world will know that you love me by the way that you love each other.
Yeah.
And so, in a time of like crisis in our world and pandemic and uncertainty and all these words we use now to describe our world, mm-hmm. like what an incredible witness and opportunity we have to show the people in our lives around us that maybe are not part of a church community like that, what biblical gospel-centered community looks mm-hmm. like.
Yeah. Yeah. I think another filter kind of that I've seen this last few months through, maybe people listening to, it's kind of been just, you know, our desired kind of pathway. And then there's like the plan B that's kind of like, okay, we have to kind of pivot and do this instead. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot of times we think that the plan B isn't as good for lots of reasons, but I've actually seen, and I know you have too, just a lot of great things come from community in the season. And so
yeah.
maybe just encourage our church a little bit and talk about what are some great ways that you've seen our church be a blessing, even rise to the occasion in a mm-hmm. way in the last 5 months.
Yeah, I think we've seen a real eagerness and urgency to care for each other.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I remember at the beginning of this, when this kind of shutdown first happened, it was like people were searching for like, who needs help? How can I care yeah. for people? And so I think right away, we just saw this eagerness of, we understand intrinsically that like the way that we can care for each other sometimes is very tangible. And mm-hmm. so, you know, things like, when the lines were really long at Costco, like who can I pick up groceries for? Or for that family that can't leave the house and is quarantined in a more constrictive way, that their groups came around them and really supported for them and grocery shopped for them on a really regular basis. So I think we saw some just really tangible ways, mm-hmm. You know, some groups choosing to say, hey, you're our people. And yeah. so we're actually going to kind of form this bubble amongst ourselves so we can still care for each other's mm-hmm. kids of these three families and yeah. still get together and have a little bit of community. But we're going to sacrifice some other things and not seeing other people so that we can still be in relationship with each other. So mm-hmm. I think really the eagerness and the urgency of, we know that now's our time to step up and yeah. to really care for each other in some tangible ways has just been really fun to see.
Yeah. Yeah. Real practically too, specifically, our church has never had like a Facebook group before. We mm-hmm. now have one. There's a couple hundred people in it, and just really cool to see people celebrate and just kind of pats on the backs and likes and thumbs up and stuff for when prayers are answered, when people step up and help one another out. So yeah, lots of ways that I feel like for all the, you know, the hardship and a lot of the things that have been difficult about the last few months, God is still using his church to live out those one another's in many ways.
Yeah. I think we've been reminded of like that community does have a purpose too, yeah. you know, like when it's just our busy lives and it's one more thing to do, it can really just feel like one more thing to do.
For sure.
But, when we see, the need that like, yeah, it's good and it's biblical to encourage one another and to prefer one another and to fight for unity, with one another, there's a real sense of like, now's our time to do that, you know? And so to see, even on that, you know, that Facebook group, to see people celebrate with each other and to see the importance of asking for prayer and to come back and follow up and say, hey, thank you for praying. This is what happened. Mm-hmm. Here's how you continue to pray. I think it's been very unifying.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm really praying that sticks as well. I think there's some good muscle memory that we've even developed over the last few months that, again, there's this sense of, oh, wasted time, but maybe not. Maybe there's actually some good stuff that can come from the last 5 months of interacting in this way really intentionally.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so I think all of this obviously takes really intentional and thoughtful leadership development as well. I think about the things that go into developing just healthy groups, healthy kind of rhythms of community in this next few months, especially as growth groups get started. You know, you and our whole staff even can't care for our entire church by yourself. That's something we talk about often. It's impossible to do that. And so that's why a big part of your job is training and kind of raising up and growing more leaders up. So what would someone need to do if they wanted to be a growth group leader at Foothill Church?
Yeah. If you are interested in being a growth group leader at Foothill Church,
let's hear the pitch.
Please come talk to me. So we ask that our growth group leaders, I mean, first and foremost, we want you to be a Christian who is growing and maturing in your faith. Our growth group leaders are not perfect. They are not, you know, seminary professors. They are not paid pastors even, but they are Christians who love Jesus and they love people. And so we want to see that developing in your life. We ask that our growth group leaders be covenant partners because as growth groups are an extension of Foothill Church, we want to be able to partner with you in that way and know that you are committed to us and we're committed to you. And so we ask that they are covenant partners. And then we generally want them to have been in a growth group. We want you to have experience of under a leadership of a experienced growth group leader, what that has looked like. So if you've been in growth group for the past year and you're like, you know, I really think I could do this. This sounds fun and exciting to me to lead a group of people. Then talk to your leader, because that's one of our desires, is that we're raising up growth group leaders from within growth groups because they've already experienced it and seen it done well under the care of a leader. And then that leader has a chance to help them to continue to develop over this, maybe this next year, so that come next fall, you're ready to step into that kind of leadership.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I think leadership development is so important when it comes to dealing with the dynamics of people. People are so just different each week.
Absolutely. I mean, our groups are, we have a huge, you know, 60 plus leaders who are leading our growth groups. Wow. And so, they are the ones that are like on the front lines caring for that group of people that God has put in their group for that season. And so, you know, they're the ones that are hearing the stories, the good and the bad, and meeting the people, the awesome and the different. And so we really desire, like, a big heart of mine is to equip our leaders and to train them and to provide them with all the resources that we can to lead their groups well. And like I said, they are, none of us are experts at this, but we can walk into each season saying, like, okay, we've learned this. And so we're going to take another step towards our people and leading them towards Jesus.
That's good. Just a quick snapshot of this specific semester coming up. What is your hope as our group's minister in terms of just equipping our people with kind of what vision for the next few months?
Well, I think we look at our world and we see that this fall is bound to be a controversial one. It's bound to be one full of tension. And I feel strongly that the church should be the place where hard conversations are had and where we can, through the grace of God, come together as brothers and sisters in Christ and really talk about how are we living out the Christian life. And so if we can't be having those type of conversations in growth groups within the church setting, filtered through the lens of scripture, like, where else are we going to have those conversations? And so my prayer, just knowing the season that we're heading into and the season we're coming from, my prayer really is that groups can be this place where we kind of flesh out and figure out, what does it really mean to live as a Christian in this, in the fall of 2020? And how can I, you know, think through that here in my growth group and talk about it and learn from people around me and look at scripture and see what it says, and then go out into my world that I'm, that God has placed me, whether that's work or my home or my neighborhood, and live that out. And so, I hope that, and my prayer is that groups can be a place that feels safe and they feel, that there's trust built and relationships built, so that, they can have those conversations and they can really figure out what it means to live as a Christian who, loves Jesus well and loves people well.
That's good. That's good. Thanks. Well, we're looking forward to seeing what God will do in us, in our church, and through us personally, and through corporate community this fall. Just a reminder, you can sign up for groups starting Sunday, August 23rd, and groups begin on Sunday, September 6th. Just go to foothill.church/groups and sign up for an in-person or online group. Those both are options for you. So speed round, three questions. Yes. We've been doing this the last few weeks, and just been fun to hear kind of a little bit more about each person. So what are some, maybe one or two new hobbies that you've picked up in the last few months, Katie?
Yeah, well, I jumped on the sourdough bread baking train.
All right.
So I have baked a lot of loaves of sourdough bread, given away not quite enough, eaten maybe one too many. but that's been really fun. I love cooking and baking. And so that's been,
what is the deal with the starter? Right. Or is there kind of a thing, right?
I mean, it's kind of like magic.
Okay.
To be honest.
What is it?
Slash maybe a miracle from the Lord, God's provision for us. It is just flour and water and you mix them together and you let it sit on your counter.
Okay.
And it, the like wild natural yeast from the air that's all around us combines with that and makes it rise. So it's like a natural rising agent.
All right. But there's some starters. Yeast, oh, go ahead. Yeah.
Oh, instead of needing yeast, you use your sourdough starter and you don't need to buy yeast.
So that's unique about sourdough bread. Then.
Correct. Okay. Yeah.
And there's some starters that have been around for like years, right? For a long time.
Right. So, you know, depending on how you take care of your baby sourdough starter. But every day or maybe twice a day, you take part of that starter and you put it in a new container and then you add new flour and water to it.
Wow.
And then you mix it up.
That's a lot
and
of
then
work.
It rises. It's really not, because it's just taking a scoop of flour and some water and stirring.
Sounds like a lot of work.
So it's like 30 seconds.
Yeah.
But then, so that starter can like carry on, but you can also very easily pass your starter on to other people. So like at the beginning of this, I passed my starter on to our friend Alina Ritza. Uh-huh. And I believe my sourdough starter now has like great grandbabies because it's been passed on to other people.
That's amazing.
So I feel proud.
Okay. What's a book that you've been reading lately that you would suggest to our listeners?
Okay. I am just about to finish a book called Get Out of Your Head by Jenny Allen. Actually, when we finished our season of women's prayer, the ladies were like, don't leave us. We need to keep meeting. And we kind of just needed to take a break to have an end time. And then we're going to start again very shortly. But we decided to read a book together and we're going to meet and kind of discuss it. And so I chose this book called Get Out of Your Head by Jenny Allen. And it is fabulous.
Cool.
It is, whether you're a guy or a girl, she writes it mainly to women, but certainly guys could benefit from it. And it talks about like the lies that we believe that are not truth from God and how we fill our minds instead with the truth of God's word and how, but it's also very practical. Sometimes we can talk about that in like a very theoretical way, but she's like, let me walk you through these different ways that you can actually do this in your life. So
that's cool.
It's been really good.
I think my wife's reading that too, right?
She is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. She likes it a lot as well.
Yeah.
So there's two Katies at least that like that book.
That's right.
Okay. Fun fact, we'll go this route actually. Fun fact, Katie DeBrancy is actually in the College Hall of Fame for tennis. Is that right?
Yeah, that feels like a stretch, but
help me with that.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, so I went to Colorado Christian University. It's not all College Hall of Fame, but the Colorado Christian University
Still impressive.
Hall of Fame for my tennis
fun fact.
There.
Maybe some of you guys didn't know that. On your staff, you have a collegiate Hall of Famer, at least for a like D2 Christian, Christian school.
Yeah.
So, okay, so here's a question. Who is your favorite all-time tennis player and why?
Oh, gosh. Well, it sounds like such an easy answer, but I mean, Roger Federer, Steve and I are like huge Roger Federer fans.
Okay.
He is literally the best.
Like,
ever.
What do you mean huge? Like, you go to his house and wave to him sometimes and...
No, well, I think he lives in Switzerland, so I would love to go to his house. Roger, if you're out there... Please invite me. But no, we just really like him. He's an excellent tennis player.
Yeah.
I'm a little obsessed with people who just like excel at things in their particular area.
Yeah.
So I'm a big Tom Brady fan as controversial as that may be, but he's so good at his particular thing. So Roger Federer is that for tennis.
It's so funny that Tom Brady's controversial.
I know he's really not he's controversial. Just, he's just really good at football.
Absolutely. Yeah. Cool. Well, Katie, thanks so much for joining us on our podcast and appreciate your time.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah.
So fun.
All right. Well, we are out of time, but thanks for joining us for our podcast Footnotes. Our goal is to release one of these each Monday, so be sure to go to foothill.church/footnotes for more information. So until next time, Foothill, peace be with you.
I believe my sourdough starter now has like great grandbabies.